decision to make. Things to lose, things to take. Pussy's about ready to cut it up. Say, wait a minute, honey, I'm gonna add it up. Oh, add it up.
We're going to devote our energies to sports and gardening, all the cultural pursuits as far as they're concerned. In fact, we're going to put the goons to sleep. Meanwhile, we dig. Go again.
Greetings and welcome to the Anadrome. And today what we're going to be doing is talking with friend of the channel, James Wallace, about how we discovered music as a child. I let him talk more about his experiences, but because I could go on forever. But nevertheless, I think you'll find this fascinating, and it may spark some of your own ideas. If you hear something, put it down in the channel. If you say, oh, I remember doing this, because that would be fascinating. So again, we're going to be going. James lives in Canada. I believe it's Toronto, or Toronto, as they say. And I live here in Tbilisi, Georgia, which you should look that up on a map if you want to know where it is. Let's go listen in to the conversation, shall we? Anyway, so we just recorded all this stuff, and then we realized I was too stupid. When they say press record, there's a second button to press, and I forgot it. So welcome to James from 20th Century Music and Arts. And you should go over to his channel. We'll put a link below. But why don't you explain to everyone what you do over there?
Basically, I like to analyze mostly music, but other arts as well. We're created, majority of it being in the 20th century, which I caught the tail end of in the last couple of decades of the 20th century. But I'm just looking at art in the 20th century and its impacts on the culture.
Yeah, and you first found me through my, How We Got Here series. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, and I really liked your analysis of how you integrated popular culture and, more importantly for me, the underground cultures that were happening in the, especially the 80s and 90s. I really found that stuff very fascinating.
Right. And so you started your channel, and your channel has, he covers things like a lot of the strange punk, post-punk stuff in the 80s, a lot of the different metal movements and such like that, but also you recommended me a few horror films, which I ended up getting the physical copies of, that I had never heard about.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Yeah. I can do the, I've horror movies. I love horror movies, but again, I'm kind of a stickler. I kind of end my horror movie somewhere in the 90s. So right. I think they sort of,
well, I can tell you have a certain, you tend to, go towards certain genres. And then when those genres kind of peter out, you're like, okay, you know.
Yeah, I think there's often peaks for music and different art movements. And people can still go back and refer to them. But there's sort of an era. Then once that era plays out, it's time to maybe go on to something else.
Yes. And as we discussed in our last conversation, the whole rock era has essentially played itself out, although there is rock music out there that's being made and such, but it no longer has much to do with the workings of the culture. It's just become a thing off to the corner. It's just like jazz. You know, there are people who keep making jazz, but all the important stuff's already been done. And so
I would agree with that. Yeah.
Yeah. So one of the things I wanted to talk about today was both of our first experiences with music, and to discuss, you know, like how we got attracted to certain styles and sounds and such. So I'm so tempted to say, like we were saying before, but I'm going to avoid doing it.
That's okay.
So let's discuss your exposure to music at a young age.
Okay.
What did you have around the house?
Well, records were played. My parents weren't really hardcore into music. So right. I grew up my first 6 years in rural Nova Scotia. And I do remember some records being played. The one I do remember is the Grease soundtrack being played by my older sisters and babysitters. My father didn't really have the best taste in music. I remember Neil Diamond being played in the car.
Right.
So I wasn't
probably late period Neil Diamond.
Yeah, I was a compilation tape, I think.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sometimes I'd hear like Tchaikovsky or something like that. And
right.
But music wasn't really a big focus of mine. And then we moved to Toronto when I was about six in 1980. And again, music, I remember one really interesting experience now that I didn't say before was I did have a neighbor up the road in Nova Scotia who came to my house, and he said, I was known as Jamie when I was a kid. He said, "Hey, Jamie, I've got something for you." And I'm like five at the time. And he pulls out a newspaper clipping, and I realized it was the four faces of the solo albums by Kiss.
Oh, right.
And I didn't know anything about Kiss, but I thought this must be cool. And it was kind of scary too. So I always thought Kiss would be something I would check out in my life at some point. And eventually right. I did. But I remember seeing that. So I was aware of things. But when we moved to Toronto, I wasn't really into music. I do remember my sister getting me, and she makes a joke, she had to go in disguise because she thought it was so uncool. But she went and got me the Michael Jackson Thriller tape. And I remember playing that as a kid. So I would have been, what, 84? So I might have been like 11 at the time. And then I'd hear some other stuff. Then I'd hear some metal and rock because we would get this was before there was a music channel called Much Music in Canada. Sort of in the after school period, there'd be like 30-minute video shows.
Right.
And we would play all kinds of random stuff. So I remember watching video shows, and sometimes the videos were actually more interesting than the music, especially early video in retrospect. It was kind of cool. But I remember, so you'd hear like those British new wave bands. My sisters at one point like Duran Duran, then they thought they were not cool anymore. And my sister got into like The Cure and things like that. So I'd hear some of that stuff. And then when like metal videos would come on, my sisters would go, "Ew." So I thought, okay, well, if it gets that reaction, it's got to be good. So
Why is she reacting like that?
Yeah, well, they just thought it was so uncool, you know? They thought for them, the sort of new wave, British, Spandau Ballet, very classy dudes were cool. Not the guy with, like, you know, studded leather and screeching into the mic. But that may be a little bit attracted to metal. But again, I wasn't a hardcore music guy. And I remember getting I did get my first cassette player, which just had one tape deck in it. I remember recording stuff off the Hard Rock station. This was when I would have been in grade 7. So I made my first precursor to an actual mixtape by just recording stuff off the radio. And I remember when like the Sammy Hagar, Eddie Van Halen stuff came out. But I wasn't familiar with, knew a little bit of this, but again, I was more interested in other things. I remember at the time I was like, I had a fish tank and I was into like aquarium fish and stuff. So music wasn't really my thing. until
I remember listening to something that really, you know, what was the first thing you remember listening to? It was just like, ooh, that's the, I got to have that, or that's my thing, or whatever.
It was, and there's a whole bunch of irony to this. It was this. Someone had mentioned that there had been a 20th anniversary for Sgt. Pepper's by the Beatles. So I went out and bought that tape.
Right.
And I would go in on a whole Beatles British Invasion splurge thing, but I heard the Sgt. Pepper tape. Now, how I heard Sgt. Pepper was different because my tape deck, actually one of the speakers was busted. So for to hear the sound of the original Sgt. Pepper's, there was this whole like singing and melody that was absent from the version I heard. I remember looking at this Beatles songbook that had the lyrics. I go, what's this section here? Right. It was absent from my version of it until I got this double tape deck where I could make tapes, and I heard, I go, oh wow, this is how Sgt. Pepper is supposed to sound. But anyway, I heard a modified version of Sgt. Pepper, I was totally into it. I thought this was awesome. Then I picked up this this British 60s compilation, and it had stuff like Ichigo Park by the Small Faces and stuff like that on it, and I thought that was really cool. And then I was picking up all kinds of Beatles tapes, and I became sort of a Beatles fanatic.
You heard 60s stuff before you heard a lot of the stuff that was from your own time.
Oh yeah, for sure. That I was 60s. It went from British Invasion to the hippie era, hippie era to the hard rock era. But I was hearing other stuff too that was contemporary or just
in the
periphery. As I got more into music and started interacting with people that were into music, they exposed me to other stuff. So I was exposed to the 1983 album by the Violent Femmes, for example. And I liked elements of that because it was real instrumental music. What I hated was, and I still do, I hate really overproduced music.
Right.
So there was a rawness to the Violent Femmes. Right. And then
we agree there.
Yeah. There's stuff like the Cult was a band that went from kind of an alternative sound to more of a hard rock sound. So I started
off the Southern Death Cult.
Yeah. The Southern Death Cult. And they were totally like kind of goth adjacent at the beginning.
Right.
And then they had this sort of heavy, almost psychedelic influenced sound. Mm-hmm. And then they went with Rick Rubin doing electric. They went total like AC/DC, Led Zeppelin. Right. And that was stuff I was also getting into too. So it was like, yeah, starting with 60s underground music, I became a real rock historian. So I wasn't just listening to the big name bands. So for example, and I found these records when I went to my mom's house a few years ago, I was into bands like Uriah Heep. Now, most people I knew didn't know who Uriah Heep was. But
Heep is pretty obscure today. They had a bit of a following when I was in high school, which was in the late 1960s, early 70s. But even then, they weren't like top shelf on anyone's shelf, you know?
Yeah, for sure. And so I would be heavily into Uriah Heep, into Deep Purple. And we were even, my friend had the pre-Ian Gillan Deep Purple, like the earlier stuff too. Mm-hmm. And I would go and get like encyclopedias or history of rock books and just like absorb the whole thing. So I remember for years going around and looking for stuff that I had read about and not being able to find it, right? My sister had this book from the early 80s called The New Rock and Roll, and it was supposed to be about what had happened from like the mid 70s. And I'd read about bands like The Birthday Party, but it was maybe almost another 10 years before I heard them, right?
Right, right.
So I all these things are kind of getting planted in my head, and I'm aware that there's underground music, there's a lot of old rock that's really cool, there's metal stuff that's really cool, and it would all kind of, I just start listening to all of it. And I remember, like, I talked to different people. So I talked to people who are total metalheads, and I'm like, I'd ask them what's some good stuff. And then I talked to goth people, and I'm like, I heard this song, and they're like, yeah, that's one by Ministry. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh yeah, that sounded pretty cool. Right. So I try and dip my hands in different
things. So was this in high school?
Yeah, this was definitely in high school. This would have been in high school for sure.
Who did you hang out with in high school?
My friends were kind of our own group. Like, we weren't like a tribe. And we liked music, but we liked a lot of different music. So I had friends that were kind of hippie-ish. I had friends that were kind of metal-ish and kind of alternative. But we weren't like – like, I remember you saying how you liked – all the different stuff from the tribes. And I was like that too. I couldn't choose a tribe. I thought that was kind of silly. And it's kind of cool that in the 90s, that all kind of disappeared. And it, yeah, things it all kind of merged together. So I liked a lot of different stuff. What I didn't like, I remember we had, I stopped going to school dances after my first year in high school. And I remember going to a school dance and they just played, I encountered what would later be known as house music. And I remember I hated this stuff with a passion. Like, I just thought this is the worst thing ever. Now, later on, I would get more open to some experimental electronic music.
Right.
But pure dance, techno, house, that kind of stuff, I still do not like.
Did you ever get into prog?
Oh, yes. Yes. So, yeah, I remember this guy I'd worked with at the CNE, he made a joke about the song 21st Century Schizoid Man. Mm-hmm. So I remember getting into King Crimson. I did get into Yes and stuff like that. I remember hearing a friend of mine had a tape of Jethro Tull music. And because it had this kind of like Celtic folk thing to it, I remember really getting into Jethro Tull for a long, like just playing the Aqualung album over and over again. On the other hand, so that's going on. But then I'm also hearing things like the Sex Pistols too, right? And the Clash and these things. So I'm also kind of listening to that. So I was kind of, my musical taste became a real stew of the history of rock, basically.
Yeah. I'm thinking as I'm listening that you happen to hit, it's almost like you got the 60s, 70s and 80s, both underground and above ground, all at once.
Yeah, and the 80s above ground was mostly rejected, except for either the real underground stuff or like musicians like Stevie Ray Vaughan. I thought that was cool, right? But like commercial 80s music, I just hated, right? But so I always felt like I'd been born too late. I'm like, oh, I wish I'd been born in the Led Zeppelin era, you know, and. Right. So that's what I was thinking at the time, anyway.
Yeah. Well, I was born during that era, and I remember when the first Led Zeppelin album came out. I didn't own that, but I owned the second one. And I thought, you know, they would play A Whole Lot of Love on the radio, but the version on the album was longer. And you often found this, the version of Light My Fire was longer on the record and that sort of stuff.
Yeah. I'll give you a funny story about A Whole Lot of Love. My friend's older sister had gotten like her first CD player and they had it in the family living room. And when I heard A Whole Lot of Love, that was another song that and TVI by the Stooges, I'm going to argue, are the two best rock songs of all time. When I first heard that, I was so beyond blown away that another time I was walking by my friend's house coming back from somewhere. I'm like, I got some time. So I knock on the front door and I go, hey, man, can I hear A Whole Lot of Love? So we go, he plays it for me and then I take off. And it's been an ongoing joke between us since then.
So did you always stay with cassettes or did you eventually get some vinyl?
The problem was, is that at our house, we had a very old 1970s record player that didn't always, it often skipped. So I had sometimes bought vinyl, but because it skipped so much, I ended up taking the vinyl to my friend's house and he would record it on tape for me. So basically, yeah, I was a cassettes guy until about the mid 90s when the CDs finally took over. And it was funny because I remember fast forwarding and rewinding through songs that if I want to hear a song again, it would be a process of rewinding and then fast forwarding.
Did you ever do this? Like a tape would get a bit gummed up and you put it on a pencil or something and you spin it around.
Yep. Many times I had tapes that I played so much, it broke. Yeah, we had tapes that when the machine would eat it, it would be like a surgical thing. One time my friend, his tape got totally destroyed. We take a little tiny screwdriver and we took apart the whole cassette and we had to screw the thing in with a pen, and we got it working, but it was like quick, very quiet surgery, you know?
Because
then other times I remember a friend of mine's tape, we were all walking together and it all got chummed up and we decided to be jerks and we just grabbed the end of the tape and started running with the tape.
There was that kind of stuff too.
Yeah, and so you know, but I mean that would happen often. One thing
I figured out with tapes and how to take care of them, and this was the same with VHS tapes, was what a lot of people would do, and you can understand this at the end of a movie. You know, people would stop as soon as the credits start rolling, and then they would rewind. And the more you do that, there's this unevenness that shows up at the end of the tape. So I realized you have to go all the way to, like with VHS, you have to go all the way to the end and then rewind every time. Yeah. And it's the same with cassette tapes. Now, cassette tapes, you turn her over so you get the other side. So some machines would allow you to go to the other side and such. But the more you stop, start, reverse, and you don't essentially level everything out, the more problems eventually. But, you know, who knew that? I didn't know that for years and years and years.
Yeah, and it was funny, too, because it's so different now. Because I remember I'd read reviews about music, and then I would go and buy it, and I didn't know whether it would sound good or not until I bought it. So you make that investment.
Right.
But I got to tell you, like, even stuff that I didn't like, at least it had some tangible meaning because it was a physical object that I had invested in.
Right. And you went looking for it.
Oh, yeah. Totally. There wasn't just these avenues of finding things like there is now. The main thing I would use, especially once I got it into, this is about 90, 91, 92, when I'm really getting into underground music, is I'm using magazines, reviews in magazines. And there were so many magazines that were great then.
What magazines did you like?
So the main ones I would get into is, okay, there were the big names like the Rolling Stone and Spin, but I didn't find those as solid. Alternative Press was a really good one.
Mm-hmm.
There was another magazine called Seconds that had interviews throughout the whole magazine. And it just had a wide variety. So you could have like Leonard Cohen and then like industrial band and then a hip hop group all in the same magazine. It was pretty cool.
Did you? Are you too young to remember Cream?
Cream was probably gone by the time I knew of Cream, but it was probably gone by the time I was really into music. There was this like thing called an alternative magazine called Reflex. I remember they had an issue on Soundgarden. I bought and they would have reviews in them. Later, there was this magazine from England called The Wire, which just had really avant-garde stuff, too. And that was a really cool magazine.
I remember that.
And I'm trying to remember what else. I mean, sometimes Maximum Rock and Roll, which dealt with like punk hardcore bands, was so exclusive because basically anybody who had ever recorded a single of anything would get a review in there. So you'd read about all these bands and it would be like so overwhelming.
Right.
I found a lot of the problem. We had an expression, like I remember there would be hardcore punk like radio shows on the university and I'd record them and there'd be like 20, 30 bands that I liked it, but it was like 20, 30 bands that sounded like each other. So we used to make this joke. We can get 30 hardcore punk bands for a dollar was my expression. As I got more into music, it was the bands that did something with that sound, that experimented with it, that made it interesting. And then with any genre of music, if people are just playing purely within that genre and not really going outside of it, it can get rather boring after a while.
Right.
Especially with something like that.
It sounds like what you did was because you were saying that you got into music about 87-ish.
And
1987. And then you started, you know, kind of like you started getting the 60s, but then you started getting stuff from the 70s, the underground in the 80s, you know, and whatever was getting to your head through the mainstream sources. But at a certain point here, it seems like, ooh, you've got a lot of catching up to do, because when we look at what you do on your channel, it's like you're going through the whole Glenn Danzig catalog right now, which is pretty amazing. I certainly, you know, I have one or two of his things, but, you know, I'm sitting there going like, oh man, this guy was all over the place.
And yeah. Yeah. Well, what happened there is, I remember, so this, I had seen big rock concerts when I was younger. So there were some really cool concerts I saw, but these were all big shows. So
what do you remember as your first shows?
Okay. So the first show I ever saw was, they had just opened the new stadium in Toronto. And I don't think when they booked this, they didn't realize this was probably too large a venue for it. So my friend called up for this Jeff Beck, Stevie Ray Vaughan concert. Now remember, we're real classic rock and we like guitar players that are really competent. So my friend said, we have fourth row centers for this thing. And there was this blind guitar player in Toronto called Jeff Healy, and he opened it. So it was Jeff Healy, Jeff Beck, and Stevie Ray Vaughan. Stevie Ray Vaughan would die the next year in a helicopter crash. So this would have been my only chance to see him.
Right.
This show
was quite a loss for music.
Oh, for sure. And so we saw this show, and we're right up front. And it's so loud and everything. And at the end, Jeff Beck and Stevie Ray Vaughan jammed, and we just got out of our seats and rushed the stage. And it was just incredible. Nice. So then, but I did get the effect of the, why I started saying, man, I got to get into some new music. So I, my friend and I then go when the Rolling Stones are playing, and it's the Steel Wheels tour. And even then they called it the Steel Wheelchairs tour, meaning these guys are old.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And this is 89. So December of 89, we went, my friend and I went down, and we have ended up buying, that was $60 for tickets each from scalpers. People who were just selling it outside the stadium. And we got some nosebleed seats, and I still thought that was a score. And I saw, we missed the opening act, but we saw the Rolling Stones.
Right.
Then I saw
I've never seen the Stones. And part of it is I developed this thing where if it was too big, like right now, someone was to say, here are Taylor Swift tickets. And even though I did this whole study on her, but they were to say, here, these are free. I'd be like, and let's say they were playing here in Tbilisi, I might be tempted to go, but for the most part, I don't like seeing shows that big.
Yeah. And I understand your drift, because then I saw like Aerosmith the next year. And then I remember watching on Much Music, there was this interview with Kim Thayil of Soundgarden. And so this guy goes, yeah, some people don't like us because we're too alternative, and some people don't like us because they're too metal. But as long as people recognize the difference, and I'm like, what is this? This is what I've been looking for. This is like my merger of everything. And there's this band from Canada called Voivod who do a heavy metal prog. They covered Pink. So there were, and then I didn't know who Faith No More was. So the show, and I missed it, it was Faith No More, Voivod, and Soundgarden. And they played Toronto. And I'm like, I just saw this. So then in the summer, there's this show where my friend introduces me to Danzig. So I see this dude who's like, looks like something from the Savage Sword of Conan and sounds like Jim Morrison, and it's heavy. I'm like, I like the Doors. I like Black Sabbath. Okay, this is cool. So then he's doing a show with Soundgarden and Corrosion of Conformity opening. And I get tickets with another group of people, and we go down, and this will be my first sort of underground show. And it was this great place called the Concert Hall, which is closed, unfortunately. It was a great place to see shows. And we go down there, and it's, the show's been canceled because apparently they wouldn't let him into the country, Glenn Danzig. So, but he honored the tickets for when he came back in late October. So I went and saw him in October with Trouble opening. This is the first time I had seen Slam Dancing, and this crowd was so mixed. There's metal dudes, there's punk dudes, and it's, I remember seeing this girl, she had like a Sid Vicious patch with an Ozzy Osbourne one, and you could feel like these things are all coming together now. So I saw this super intense show. There's Slam Dancing, gets in a fight with a guy in the audience. It was insane. I'd never seen anything like this. I'm gonna go, why the hell am I paying $60 to see the Rolling Stones in the stadium? Right. Because all this underground music. So, and I remember even seeing AC/DC like 2 weeks later, and I liked the show, but again, it was another stadium show, and it seemed lame. So then I just said, I'm going to just see underground bands. And this sort of sums up what I was seeing. In early February, there was a guy at my school who got 3 Slayer tickets, and no one, this was 91, early 91. So we've been the Seasons of the Abyss tour. No one wanted to go with him. And so me and my friend said, yeah, we'll go. And he was kind of well off, so he gave us the tickets for free. So we go and see Slayer. And it was at this place called Massey Hall, and someone actually jumped off the balcony and the crowd caught them. This is a seated area, wow. Right? It's actually a fancy place.
That takes a fair amount of guts to do that.
Oh my goodness. You should be, this was insane. And that was one of the loudest shows ever. That probably started my tinnitus. 2 weeks later, another friend of mine, his favorite band is The Replacements. And I'm back at the concert hall, that other place. And I see The Replacements 2 weeks later. So these were the kind of shows we started going to. We went to these smaller shows and we realized there were all these underground bands. And then this thing, and I didn't get to go, but people told me about that first Lollapalooza when it came to Toronto and seeing stuff like the Rollins band. And I had just gotten into the Rollins band. And again, there's this Black Sabbath noisy thing going on with them. And I thought that was awesome.
Right.
And Jane's Addiction was like a new Led Zeppelin or something. It was really cool as well. And then people told me about that show and how incredible it was. And then in September of that year, I watched this video called Smells Like Teen Spirit. I thought, this is pretty awesome. Now, what's funny is there was a magazine called, what was it called? Propaganda. It was like a goth adjacent magazine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it had it, and like summer 1990, I bought it because it had Chris Cornell's Soundgarden in it. And it had a thing on Danzig as well. But Chris Cornell's wearing this Nirvana t-shirt, but nobody knew who Nirvana was. And the caption said, "Yes, Chris, we're all in Nirvana now." Not knowing this band the next year would just create a complete revolution.
Right.
So observing what happened next was the funniest thing for me, because there was all this underground music that if you had played it, like, okay, I'll tell you another story that's funny too. I had a cassette of Louder Than Love by Soundgarden. And I went with a friend of mine's family on a road trip down to Ohio to go to this amusement park called Cedar Point down there.
Right.
And we're playing this in the car. People described it as cats being tortured. They just hated it. They thought it was noisy and the Chris Cornell vocals, they thought it was terrible.
Right.
A year later, they're listening to the Bad Motorfinger album, right? Mm-hmm. And it was interesting. Once Nirvana broke through, everyone decides, oh, this is the kind of music we have to be into now.
Right.
So
right.
People who were into like MC Hammer like a year before are now becoming kind of grunge. People who are into hair, like you watched hair metal just get destroyed. And I remember hating hair metal like 2-3 years before its death and making fun of my friend for having like White Lion tapes and stuff like that.
Did you ever see those movies by Penelope Spheris, The Decline of Western Civilization?
Yeah, I watched them later. So especially the the Metal Years Part Two.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's quite funny to watch now. But yeah, they point out how over the top the hair metal is. But it was just it wasn't even trying. You know, the music was just. It's very sad too, because the guy who was in the band Warrant, who did Cherry Pie, he said that he wrote that song on a whim because the record company had been had said, "There's no love in an elevator. There's no big hit here. You got to do a big hit for us." So he writes that song and he said, "That's the only song I was ever known for. I had this hard album, and now I'm the Cherry Pie guy. I'm eating Cherry Pie contests," and he's like, "I could have shot myself for writing that song. That's all I'm known for." And he ended up dying from alcoholism. You know, so I mean, it's being that one hit wonder. I mean,
that's the kind of stuff I talk about in the How We Got Here. How so much of this was, it was essentially, to me, I mean, my whole perspective is that you had this period of innocence in the 1950s with rock and roll. And then you get to this period where people are really exploring this new music in the 1960s. And then it starts to get commercialized, but then this metal stuff and whatnot is bubbling underneath. Then the punk stuff comes. But all of it is easily commercialized. And it kills the soul. It kills the soul in two ways. Is that one is the commercialization kills the soul. But the other one is, sometimes these rock and roll lifestyles are just really dangerous, you know, and so you have these people who, you know, I feel for them. I mean, when I lived in New York City, these are the people I knew, and they're trying to get to somewhere, and it's such a dangerous road that you're on.
Yeah, for sure. There's always wrestling with the darkness and the addiction. And that's interesting how you had the with Ian MacKay and Minor Threat, the Discord Records, they do the whole straight edge movement. Now, right. It would kind of turn into this weird militaristic thing with some of the later incarnations of it. But they were saying, and Henry Rollins was kind of part of that too, they were just saying that, well, this is going to be, we're going to be the opposite of that. Like, right. We don't want to be Sid Vicious. I love his music, but he's a junkie. I'm not a junkie, right?
Right.
So, and that was looking for a kind of, I think, something different that, you know, that nihilism is just going to take you to the really, really dark edge here. Yeah, it's sad. I mean, you have some people who are sort of functional in that kind of world of abuse. But if eventually it catches up with them, I mean, I did a whole thing on probably one of my favorite bands of all time is The Fall. And Marky Smith was like a workaholic, but he was also addicted to methamphetamine, cigarettes, and alcohol. And the cancer eventually got him, right?
Right.
Now, he would argue, hey, this is how I wanted to live, right? But,
right.
I mean, you're always going to be playing with fire doing that. And, I mean, that's not exclusive to music. I mean, you go
back to the arts. It is a very particularly late half of the 20th century thing, where people are trying to – to me, what happened was so much of the meaning of society got emptied out through, various processes, which I won't go into here. But then what happens is you feel something intense in the music. And so you start to live for the music. But then what happens is, in the end, music by itself – isn't strong enough to hold you. And interestingly enough, also, given the modernist idea of pulling things apart, the music keeps getting heavier and crazier and noisier. And that gets into your head. I mean, I remember I had a friend in New York City. She seemed like a pretty normal girl. Found out later she was a heroin addict. But she'd be listening to stuff, and you should pull her headphones off and just hear this. And you realize, oh, that's all going inside. That's part of how she sees the world. And so whether it's, you know, I really don't like the overproduced stuff. But in the end, if you go the complete opposite way, you end up in this chaos of noise and sound.
Yeah, I that's the thing. I mean, I like some of the extreme stuff, but I guess when you get it, like, there's, and it's interesting, in that extreme heaviness blur of noise, there's actually large subgenres that if you weren't used to hearing those sounds, you wouldn't be able to recognize the differences. So if you have a grindcore, power violence, Japanese right. noise, everything that's just taking it to like where you just have a blur of sound.
Yeah.
It's cool to go there, but it's not cool to stay there.
Right.
That's what I would say.
The way I look at it from my perspective, living in New York City, precisely during the period you're describing of the late 80s, early 90s. And, you know, I knew people like Thurston Moore. I knew, you know, John Spencer lived across the hall from me. I knew all these different people. And as to me, it was like the music, which I really appreciated. Now, I'm older than them, by Thurston Moore, but not that much, by John Spencer, by at least John Spencer's closer to your age. But what I noticed was that it's like they were reaching to find something. And in the end, it's not that there's nothing there, but it's that they pulled it apart so much. John Spencer, after Pussy Galore, starts reassembling kind of a bluesy kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And it becomes more, I wouldn't call it exactly standard blues or anything, but it's got a definite substance. As Sonic Youth, by the time you get to their 90s material, you know, some of their 80s stuff, they're really pulling things apart. But yeah. By the time you get to the 90s, you start getting them trying to, in a sense, find ways to push it back together to keep it musical.
Yeah, well, yeah, but okay. So a couple of things. I've got a couple of funny John Spencer stories. One is, I saw him when I visited my sister in Montreal in 93, and it was in a very small club. On one of your streams, what was the name of that group that you were trying to play, but then YouTube wouldn't allow a live stream? It was called, were they the Muffs? Is that the name of that band?
Yeah, well, I was just playing their official video.
Yeah, but so
for whatever reason, YouTube caught that. And
it was funny because the place we saw them at was basically a bar, and I'd seen the Muffs set before. I didn't really know them, but I knew that both those bands were opening up for the Goo Goo Dolls in Toronto the next night. So I'd had a couple of drinks. I'm 19. I go outside.
We were all on Warner Brothers.
Yeah, so. And she, the singer's there, and I go to her, hey, you guys are playing with the Goo Goo Dolls in Toronto. And she's like, yeah. How far is the drive to Toronto? And I told her and stuff. Then we're watching the bass player in the band, and he's trying to talk to these guys. And I don't think he understood the fact that Quebec is a French-Canadian area, because he goes, you guys are French, right? Because I can tell by the sweaters, you're French. And he's like, they're like, yeah, we are French-Canadian. They're just trying to explain that this is a French area. And it was kind of funny. But then I saw John Spencer 2 years later at a much larger venue in Toronto called the Opera House. And it was sort of this hip. It was all the hip people that showed up, and people are doing like pseudo rockabilly hair to try and see how cool they were. And it was funny that for this is the hippest place to be. Me and my friend are waiting outside, and obviously John Spencer had put some people on the guest list and there was a problem. So he just walks up to the front and talks to the guy, blah, blah. Yeah. Let them in. So here's the star of the show. He walks through the whole crowd, and basically nobody knew who the heck he was.
No.
It shows you when people want to be hip to like something. But anyway, with the Sonic Youth thing, though, Sonic Youth always had this shimmering kind of beauty to them, too. I absolutely love the Sister album. So, yes, they have that noise, but in that noise, they've got this kind of shimmering beauty underneath that I found so fascinating.
My favorite band of the New York noise bands was Band of Susans.
Did you ever spend any time with them? Yeah, I know. I'm aware of them. I remember that one of the guys in Helmet had played with them, and they had like a three guitar lineup. Yeah, I think I have one of their cassette tapes, The Word and something. I forget what it's called now. But yeah, no, they were great.
No, they were good friends of mine in New York, and I'm still in contact with Robert Poss, who's the main guitarist, and then Susan Stenger was the second one. They had three Susans in the band at one point, which is why they're called Band of Susans. But and she was a very good friend of mine. She ended up moving to London, and I lost contact with her. But what I really liked about their stuff was it was really crafted and sculpted. And but all of them were connected to this guy Glenn Branca.
His
guitar orchestras in the no wave period.
Yeah.
And I really like their last albums, which is, Last Temptation of Susan is one of the names of the songs. But it has this thing, there's a song on there called Elizabeth Stride, which is based on one of the victims of Jack the Ripper. And it's about a 7-minute piece, and it starts off, Susan sings this very low voice, and then it builds into this escalating scale of guitar noise that just is, it's beautiful, but it becomes more and more frightening as it goes, and then it trails off to one last verse at the end. Just absolutely amazing music.
The band that really played that out, and I wasn't so familiar with their stuff in the 2000s, but I really want to get into it now after watching this documentary, is the Swans.
Yeah.
Because they start out very nihilistic, and then they get this singer from the South, Jarbo, and she brings these sort of beautiful vocals in there, and it's so interesting what they start doing with the music then.
Yeah, I have all their nihilistic albums, and they were brutal and frightening.
Yeah,
and then she comes in, and they take on this more of a dreamlike quality.
Yeah,
which is weird because Michael Jira is like anything but a dreamlike.
But they showed the stuff by the time they get to the late 90s, they're doing a kind of post rock thing.
Yeah.
Before the post rock, and and they showed the concerts, and it was just this. Someone said in the documentary that she came up to him because he would meet everyone after the show. He would just stay there and everyone could come up and talk to him, which is cool. And she said, I suffer from anxiety, but because of the loudness of the sound, she said she felt something kind of push inside of her. And she said, I don't feel the anxiety now. It's pretty wild. But yeah, I mean, that New York scene in the 80s, did you ever see the band Live Skull?
No, and they were friends of mine, but that was one I kind of missed. So the problem with New York is there's just way too much music.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
I mean, one of the reasons I left New York in 96 was simply because I had so many friends playing music by that time that I could literally, and I mean that in the most literal sense of the word, go to a rock show of friends of mine and other related stuff every night of the week, which was just too much.
You know? Yeah, yeah. You know what? You can burn out the music
too much. And I remember a few shows that were like way over the edge. You know, there was one show, the Candy Snatchers, great garage punk. Eric Davidson wrote this book. I don't know if you have it called, what is it? The word gunk is in the title,
it's about the Garage Underground, right?
Yeah, and it's all about the later part of it.
Yeah. I've heard
and,
of it.
In the 90s and up, he stops at the White Stripes and that. But there was this one group called the Candy Snatchers. They were from, I think, Virginia. But they came up, and I remember things like someone brought an entire sturgeon. From the down in Lower Manhattan at the fish market.
Oh wow!
And they brought it and started swinging it all through the it's by the tail all through the. Meanwhile, the main singer has cut his head open with glass on the stage. There's glass all over the place, and there's the blood of the fish. Fish parts are going everywhere. And I'm sitting there saying to myself, yeah, I was about 41 years old. I said,
yeah, I'm too old for this now. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And that's the one thing that's interesting is that rock and roll and rock music is really kind of associated with youth and that youthful energy. Mm-hmm. But if you stay too long, you either get these kind of like, what you see with a lot of bands who just do it as a job, it's sort of like a corporate thing. They do it as a 9-to-5 job, you know, someone babysits their kids while they play. So that kind of edge is there. But then the other side is it's just like, it's embarrassing. I remember going to a Motorhead show in 1995 and the singer from the Forgotten Rebels was there and he was still all punked up and he looked like he was almost about 40. And I'm looking at this guy going, you know, adults should kind of eventually act like adults, you know, and it kind of looked kind of pathetic too.
Yeah. You know, well, right. One of the things though that I appreciated so much from this scene. And at that time there was no real name for it. People will call there's this thing from the late 80s through the early 90s, going a bit beyond Kurt Cobain's death, and we don't really have a name for it.
Yeah,
people will say grunge or alternative, but those names don't really fit it. I kind of call it the postmodern era, but that doesn't really fit it either. And noise music in New York, but all of those are more specific to certain.
Yeah, it's the generalized underground music scene. It's the only way I could describe it.
Yeah, but one of the things that I really appreciated was, and I don't see it now in music, was people were trying to do something.
Yeah.
People were trying to make, there was an edge. There was a sense of, you know, what are we trying to prove to ourselves? Well, we know we're trying to prove something, even though by that point, what that something is was very hard to define. Nevertheless, when you compare it to so much music made today, there's just no edge on it. You know, whether it's studio production or this, I've noticed that the music I've heard from the last 15 years or so, it all seems to have this like quality to it. It's it's all kind of yearning, and some of it has these pretty vocals or whatever. And then you have rap music that's all vibey, and it's just like
this. Yeah.
You know, and it doesn't, you know, it's like there's a world of difference between the rap music made today and, say, the first time I heard Ice-T sing in Colors.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely.
And, you know, that felt like it had a serious edge on it, and it meant something. And likewise, you know, these noise experiments, they meant something. Something was, you were risking something. Something was at stake. Whereas for most music today, there's not much at stake.
Well, and I think that's what happens with a lot of genres. Like at the one of the university stations in Toronto, they have this blues show. And there's a guy really into blues music, but the sort of new blues bands that kind of play bars, I'm hearing them, and it's just, it's so pedestrian, this music. Yeah. It's not bad, but it's just so pretty. It's like, I'm feeling bluesy, I'm so bluesy. It's like, rock has got to kind of, so I see what you do, the edge here, is you want to kind of push it a little bit and come up with your own sound and your own idea and your own authenticity. But maybe once that plays out, it does become sort of a, I don't know, like just a uniform thing. Like you said about jazz, it's not really about innovation anymore. It's just sort of playing a style. And it is cool that there are people who will come and do authentic hot jazz or swing jazz and say, I'm going to totally recreate that era. That's cool that there's people that do that. But
a very good friend of mine, Deke Dickerson, plays old school country and old school rockabilly. I brought him up to Alaska along with Barents Whitfield, who's a name you should know. Barents Whitfield does this kind of garage rock, but also kind of 1950s rock and roll. These guys are great, but at the same time, it's very niche. You know, it's just, it's, you know, this isn't, no one's expecting these guys to make a lot of money. They, you know, they do play around, and people in Europe really like them because the people in Europe are like that. They like weird American stuff.
Yeah.
When they even know about it. But
yes, I mean, sometimes things get all played out. And then, of course, there's the whole fragmentation of the internet with so much is available now.
Well, that's another problem, isn't it?
Yeah. So, I mean, I remember I was kind of out of music by the time the internet took off, but I remember going into some of these sites like allmusic.com. And if I had discovered that, if that had been around 5 years earlier, oh my God, it would have overwhelmed me because I would just go from band to band to band to band. And eventually I'd stop after 2 hours and go, my brain's full. I can't do this anymore.
Right.
There's so much, only so much you can take in at a time. And I think
Discogs often, but that's because I'm looking for specific records. And also sometimes I want to know what songs were on a record.
Yeah,
and they
have
all the lists of all the variations of albums. So that's very helpful to me. And I'm still very passionately into music. I just got a CD today of Robin Trower's greatest hits.
Oh,
because I realized
that Bridge Over the River Sighs, amazing.
Procol Harum, I really liked is when he would step into a place that had organ and piano, and there'd be such a tension between the classical organ sound and his very Jimi Hendrix inspired guitar riffs. And so I've been listening to it, and I thought, like, oh, this is very good, and I missed that. And so a lot of what I do is I end up going back and filling in holes of things that were just on the shelves all the time. Because I worked in a huge record store in New York City at the beginning of the 80s, which I'm realizing now was in many ways one of the best periods to buy albums. Because the CDs hadn't come yet. And when the CDs would come, the record company's first line of defense was to start making the vinyl actually worse.
Yeah.
And making it softer, making it so it would run out so that they could sell you their new CDs for an inflated price.
For sure.
And then, but at that time, they were also in the early 80s, they were putting out all these box sets. You started getting Bear Family box sets from Germany and such, where you had all of this old stuff coming back. So it was a great period. For, you know, I collected a lot of the punk and new wave stuff. And then while I was working there, I started noticing all the stuff related to hardcore and also the different metal forms. So they allowed me to make a section for both of those. I had tons of albums, and I noticed it's like, okay, Michael Jackson is selling, you know, like, I don't know, 25, 30 million copies of, at that time, there's a lot more now, of Thriller. But look how many bands there are of this other stuff. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, when people get into that kind of music, whether it's underground metal or punk or experimental music of any kind, those are the people who are probably going to be interested in actually trying to develop it and play it too. Mm-hmm. Right? Most mainstream people, like, the big hits is just on in the background. So yeah, Michael Jackson's moving that numbers, but how many Michael Jackson type singers were there as opposed to how many thrash metal bands you were finding coming in, right?
Yeah, no, Michael Jackson was a phenomena, but he was not an influence.
No.
Very few people are singing in a Michael Jackson style today. Every now and then someone will say, oh, you know, maybe Drake does a little of this or The Weeknd or something. But not really, you know. And I think also that stuff was sold to what we would call, when I worked in a record store, the amateurs.
Yeah.
People who didn't really listen to music, but they would get this big record that you couldn't avoid hearing.
Yeah. I remember there was a record store in Toronto called The Record Peddler, and these guys would like grill you and were like super cold and mean until you kind of proved yourself that you knew about music. So I remember going in one time and first time I've ever heard Slayer. I'm like, what is this? And the guy behind the counter just looked at me and went, Slayer. Right? Like, they just didn't want to talk to you unless you kind of proved yourself that you had knowledge. Right?
Right.
So over the years, then, you know, you can get comfortable talking with them, but if you came in as sort of a total amateur, they would just look down.
Well, you of course have seen High Fidelity.
Yeah, exactly. I so related with that.
Yeah. Well, there was High Fidelity and Empire Records.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing about Empire Records was I helped put the Band of Susans poster that's featured in that. I gave that to them.
Oh,
but
cool.
The thing is that one doesn't feel like a real record store. You know, the relationships and the people working there, all these cute girls. A lot of cute girls did not work in record stores.
For sure.
If you got like six guys of whatever persuasion working there, maybe you'd get a girl working there. You know, I mean, it was a very low percentage. I worked in this one huge record store, J&R Music World, and I was in charge of massive quantities of records. And but then I worked in this small independent record store in Soho, New York, called Rocks in Your Head. And I was I worked there maybe 15, 16 hours a week, but I also bought and sold record collections. So Tom Verlaine from Television would come in. I ended up buying a record collection of his, but I didn't have the money to pay. I would normally give like a dollar a record or something. This was in the 90s. So I told him, look, if I just buy it outright from you, I'm going to pay you a dollar. But if you just give it to me, let me process it, we'll split it three ways. You get a third, I get a third, the owner of the store gets a third. And he agreed to that. So I'd see him every week for like quite a while. And there were other people who did the same thing with me.
That's wild.
Yeah.
So you knew Tom Verlaine. What kind of stuff was in his collection? Do you remember?
Well, here's the weird thing about his collection. I went over to his house once to look at this stuff. And he had tons of records just lying in piles on the floor. And what he said he did is he would go around to thrift stores, garage sales. He would go to record stores, you know, ethnic record stores, whatever. And he was looking for anything that had a guitar on it. Then what he would do is he'd listen to the record. If he didn't hear what he was looking for, he'd put it in the get rid of pile. And if he did, then he would learn the lick that he wanted. And then he would put it in the farewell pile. He didn't do that with everything. He kept a certain amount of records. I took about 1,000 records off of him, but he had another 1,000 that he didn't want to get rid of.
That's wild, because Television Sound, that Marquee Moon album, is so incredible. It holds up so well, and it's unique.
It never sounds dated.
No, and it's so unique. It's almost like they got this like jammy not quite Grateful Dead, but kind of that feel to it. Like, it's not a riff heavy.
The Birds thing. Was a big influence on them. But, you don't think immediately of them the way you do with Tom Petty.
Yeah.
But there was something in the overall vibe that they liked. And Roger McGuinn used to always say they were trying for this, and he would just make the sound like a jet airplane. And that's what he was trying to do. And that's what Tom Verlaine got, was this vibe off of it. But, of course, he listened to so many different people. And I think that and he would always say to me, it's just like, I don't know why they put me as a punk.
Yeah.
But I guess they called the whole scene kind of like that. And in a way it was. But we weren't particularly antagonistic towards the people who came before us. Although we did think that things were getting bloated and big. Yeah. And so in that sense, they were like that. I have a good story from the record store, Rocks in Your Head. And the way it worked is I stocked all of my records in there. So I came in there and dealt with the prices and such. And then once a week, I would deal with the owner and get the money and do that sort of stuff. But we also had all these CDs. We had a cassette case, but the CDs and the cassette cases were all behind glass. So you had to get someone to come over, open it for you. One really funny one was, I'm talking to someone and someone calls out over from near where the Velvet Under, we had all these bootleg CDs, which was like a whole underground industry that I don't
think
so much anymore. But someone was over there looking at those. And they called out to me, "Hey, can you open up this case for me?" And I look over and I'm thinking to myself, "Gosh, who does this guy think he is? Lou Reed?" Yeah, it was.
Oh man, that's awesome.
Because he was just exactly like you would imagine Lou Reed. You know, it's just like
Rather cantankerous.
Hey, right? Open this case up. and I was thinking like, you know, hey Lou, are you gonna report us for this? But no, he wanted to buy some of the copies. I said, "Well, let me give you a big discount on them since they're basically yours."
That's hilarious, man.
Yeah, even better one is one day David Lee Roth comes.
Oh in, yeah, yeah.
And he's got this like thing, a bandana on his head, and he's still got the longer hair. It's a couple years after his mountain climbing. Just a Gigolo album.
Oh, you know? Eat Him and Smile or something. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So he comes in and he says to me, "So what are you listening to these days?" Like, I'm the cool person who knows. And he goes, like, "You don't want to really ask me. I don't listen to cool stuff." And he goes, "No, man, just tell me. What are you listening to?" And I said, "No, I just, you know, well, the kind of stuff I listen to is not cool at all." And he goes, "No, whatever it is you sell me, I'll buy it." And I said, "Come on." And he goes like, "You know who I am." And I said, "Yeah, I know who you are." and so I opened up the case and pulled out this double album of Greek music from the 1920s and gave it to him. I said, "There you go."
So he never went and made that 1920s Greek folk influenced album after.
No, I tried to warn him.
Well, who knows? I mean, he might have been a bit of a more open-minded guy.
Well, maybe he really liked it. Maybe he understood it. I don't know. But you know, it's just like I pulled the New York attitude on him. Yeah, I know who you are.
Yeah. Well, you know, people. You know what? They probably if you always have people that are kind of doting on you, it's probably refreshing dealing with someone who actually doesn't care or doesn't even know who you are.
Well, I've never been, unfortunately, I've never been much of a Van Halen fan. I appreciate Eddie's prowess on the guitar.
Their first album was incredible. Exactly. I still find that's incredible.
But after that, I was just never much of a fan. So, but sometime, like you say, you want to talk to me about my 80s experiences.
Yeah.
Just a couple of them there. But
that's awesome. Yeah, I'd absolutely love to do that.
Well, before we go here, let me just tell you a little bit about how I discovered music. I grew up without music in the house, except for what was on the radio. And my mother says I would sing La Bamba as a 3-year-old or 4-year-old or something, going, you know, just that's all, you know, who knows what I was doing. Because I don't have any recollection of it. But if my mother said I was doing it, that sounds good to me. And it says to me, oh, you had good taste, Brian. Later, my mother bought a stereo system. But what was strange about that is she never listened to music. She had about four or five records. Someone saw her coming, talked her into some stereo system, you know, the kind that would open up like a shelf and would take a stack of records and such. And one of the records she had was an Edith Piaf record, a double set of her best hits. And she's this great French singer, so great that I remember in 2005, I was traveling through France watching a television program of who were the greatest French people of all time. She came in number one.
Wow. So,
she beat out Louis XIV and Napoleon and Charles de Gaulle and all these other people, which is fascinating. It was like a television poll, so take it for what it's worth. But anyway, I was really grateful for that later because I liked some of those, and eventually I grew to really respect her music. But that was about it. And then sometime around 66, 67, it was before 67, I remember starting to listen to the radio, although I had been kind of hostile to the Beatles earlier. And I remember with a friend of mine, we were both watching television at the Beatles playing about, I don't know, 65 or so live on Ed Sullivan or something going on. And my friend goes like, no talent bums. And I said, yeah. Later he becomes a hippie. So I wonder how that opinion changed. And I ended up getting the Sgt. Pepper's album very early in 67. And I think part of what was happening was I started hearing things on the radio. And then I started listening to this local San Francisco Bay Area station called KFRC. And they had such a great mix of music that they would play the Beatles, of course, and they would play the British Invasion, but they'd also play all of the San Francisco psychedelic bands. And the interesting thing about that was we had hits in our area that no one else had because of that. So I became very familiar with those bands. We also had sometimes they play country, you know, some of the better country music. They would play, sometimes you get a little bit of blues. You'd get Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra still had hits in like 66, 67. So it was a very interesting mix of times. In a way, you could feel two eras colliding and passing by each other. But for me, what I remembered most were the rock bands. And I remember the garage bands in particular. And we didn't use that terminology at the time. And I remember, though, you know, all these bands, like 13th Floor Elevators was one of my favorite bands. And they were like a psychedelic band, but they're really a garage band, you know. Yeah. And, I remember also one of my favorite experiences was the first record I ever bought for myself was the Buffalo Springfield's 45 of For What It's Worth, which is a great song.
Do you still have it?
Huh?
Do you still have it? That would be worth a lot now.
Well, I have it, but not that specific copy. It's not worth that much. It was a pretty big hit. And plus, I played mine to death. You know, yeah. It was just so. But I remember there were these girls who would hang around inside the school when I was in sixth grade. And they were listening to music at lunchtime. So I brought in my little 45 and said, can we listen to this? And they were listening to Paul Revere and the Raiders, like, you know, Him or Me or Good Thing, something like that. And so they put this on their little portable record player, and then they all went, ew, and so they had to take it off. And then they went back to listening to Paul Revere and the Raiders. And I'm of two thoughts of that interaction. One was, for a long time, I thought, well, I was the one who had the taste. But now I look back and go, no, I think it was Paul Revere and the Raiders. Because and Quentin Tarantino uses two of their songs very prominently in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and they sound so good. Whereas Buffalo Stills, For What It's Worth, has been played so, every time someone wants to make a political point from the 1960s, they use the Buffalo Springfield.
Yeah, for what it's worth. And Turn by the Birds. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. So the first albums I got. Here are the first albums. The Monkees. The second Monkees album. Can you guess what number three was? I'll give you a hint. It's not at all like the monkeys.
Did you get either Blue Cher or Frank Zappa?
No, Frank Zappa is still someone I'm just now coming to terms with. But no, and Blue Cher is a bit later. No,
Jimi Hendrix.
No, he wasn't out yet. It was the Doors' first album.
Oh wow! Okay.
So yeah, that kind of, and then after that, I got Sgt. Pepper's.
Wow.
And Procol Harum. Well, Procol Harum was a little bit later in the year, but that tells you where my head was. On one hand, there was this like pop stuff, and then there was Jim Morrison singing.
And that was the transition when that change happened.
Yeah, that year, it's like all the stuff changed. But really, the change is already starting in 66. And a lot of it is because of Dylan's change in 64, 65, and then the Beatles' change in 65 into 66.
Yeah.
And for sure, everybody else is scrambling to catch up. And then some people realize, oh, we can do our own thing that sounds really fantastic.
Yeah.
So, you know, there was just a lot of great music. But the best thing, I won't go on too long about this, but because it's just a whole thing in itself. But I didn't go to any concerts. And in a way, I'm glad I didn't, because the concerts I would have gone to were in San Francisco. And I was across the bay in San Rafael. And that would have been the heyday of then, but I was much too young. He's like 14-year-old going to the Fillmore. No, didn't want to do that. And when I was about 15, I really wanted to go to Altamont.
Oh boy.
And I'm so glad. Well, they moved it. It was going to be much closer to me at this place called Sears Point. I could have easily gotten there, but then they moved it across the bay over to this place, Altamont. I couldn't make it. And I'm so glad I did.
Yeah.
Because that just would, when I look at what happened there, I'm just like, yeah, I made the right choice. So, yeah. Or rather, the choice was made for me. And the thing I remember most from that period, as far as getting into music and such, was these really cool record stores. So there was one in San Rafael and one in the next town over, San Anselmo. And you'd walk in and there'd be all this music, and the people behind the counters knew it, and they could, you know, push you, and they would order things. So I asked them, can you get me, there's a song called You're Gonna Miss Me by the 13th Floor Elevators. And they got me the 45, and I was so happy to get that. I play it over and over again. It's still one of my all time favorite songs. But the one in San Anselmo had psychedelic posters everywhere. And one of the things they did was, for every psychedelic poster from the Fillmore, they had a sheet on the side where they would also make little handbills for it. And I had this huge collection of about 150 Fillmore and Avalon handbills from that time. Wow. Unfortunately, where did they go? I think I gave them to a friend of mine after I joined up with a Jesus People group in 1970. One of the reasons I did that was because the music was already letting me down. Mm-hmm. And the radio station had changed a lot and become, you know, they were starting to play the Jackson 5 and the Carpenters and the Archies and mm-hmm. the Osmonds. And it was just like, hey, you took away the Rolling Stones. I mean, yeah, they'd still play the Rolling Stones when they had it. And I did listen to FM radio. But there was a radio called KMPX, which was very experimental. And I learned a lot from them. So they would play like some blues song followed by Beethoven.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah. But then the other one was KSAN. KSAN became what you'd call like a cream rock station. So that is to say, they were the ones playing all the more hard rock stuff and whatnot. But I think had I not become part of the Jesus movement at that point, I would have gone that direction listening to music, but I was already exploring the limits. I was hearing that, the Beatles reference, or there was these references to classical music. And then I would go down to the public library and look for classical music, or I'd look for the blues. And so I was very much already, by the age of 15, my tentacles were getting much further out than most people I know. And then after I became part of the Jesus movement, then I started buying the very first Christian rock records that there ever were. And I eventually just got rid of most of my rock records, which I always regretted later. I just said, "How can we do that?" But then eventually I got rid of the Jesus music too, which I also said, "Why did you do that?" Because there was a lot of interesting stuff in there. But the reason for that is because I let everyone play them and they were all zipped up. But and no one was making me get rid of the rock records. I actually just thought, like, well, maybe I can buy a Christmas gift for my mother. And I got rid of, I had 545s and over 100 albums. And I took them to a used bookstore. No one knew anything about selling records, used records then. And got rid of them for, I don't know, $15.
Oh, heartbreak.
Yeah. And I had a lot of original stuff. So, you know, I think one of the last albums I had was King Crimson's
Court of the Crimson. Crimson King. Yeah.
Yeah. Which later, but I would have played those to death anyway by the time I got older. So,
yeah.
But now I have, of course, almost everything I ever bought. I think there's one or two records that I had during that period that I don't have now. But yeah. I have almost all the same material from it somewhere. So
that's cool.
Wow. Okay. Any last comments?
No, I just think it's interesting that you were exposed to that very rich San Francisco scene, but you really didn't get to see much live stuff. And
none.
The
first and then live ones were, I started playing music myself at 16. The only live music I had seen up till that point was, I think I saw one Western swing band somewhere. And then I saw one of the things I kicked myself over was that the Music Machine was going to be playing somewhere. And I didn't get a chance to see them. I would love to have seen them. But then there were these, I was watching these weird Christian folk rock bands playing. And then I was in one myself. So...
but then you go to like the Lower East Side CBGBs, and that's like your exposure to live music, a lot of it.
Basically,
like that's a big extreme change there.
Yeah, but I got into music when I was about 12, 13. By that time, it was about 11 years later. So I did go through England during the punk scene and bought a few records at this big record store. And that was on my way to Switzerland, this place, La Brie. But while I was there, I had already started buying cassettes of, I'd heard somewhere, I saw this news thing about 11 o'clock news, and they were doing a thing on, you know, this new band in London is upsetting everyone. They're called the Sex Pistols. We're sorry if that offended you, but that is the name of the, you know. And so some like CBS News or something was doing this. They wouldn't put it on the 6 o'clock news, but they put it on the 11 o'clock news. And I happened to catch that. And I said, things are changing again. And so that's what got me to start listening to music again.
Wow.
And then I had a cassette collection. While I was in Europe, I bought cassettes mostly. And then when I got back to America, I shifted over completely to albums. So I got rid of a third collection, the cassette collection.
Oh, boy. So, yeah. Okay. Well, I guess the next time we talk, if you could kind of highlight some of the maybe the best performances and experiences of that New York scene in the 80s.
Yeah, well, there's two parts to it. There's the – when I arrived there, it was 1980 – so I picked up on the tail end of the punk and new wave stuff.
Yeah.
And then there was kind of a down period. So, you know, 1984, you know, it's just musically not so interesting. Maybe it was, but I wasn't connecting to it. And then I started connecting with the new stuff about 1989. And then I went from connecting with it to having friends who were doing it all.
Yeah.
And I think part of the reason for that was I was slightly older than everyone. Slightly, like 5-10 years, and so I was more respected in a sense. So I've got two sets of
okay. That's that. I'd love to hear about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, James. Well, we will talk again
For sure.
Do you want a copy of this for your channel?
Yeah, sure. Let me think about it. I wanted to do a conversation with just you on the...
yeah, well, you can always hold on to this.
Okay. Well, you know what? Send me a copy. I'll hold on to it.
Okay.
And then I'm going to look into if we could do a conversation about New York in the 80s.
What I will do is not send you a copy, but send you a link. Then you can download it for yourself.
Okay, cool.
Okay, well, have a good time up there in Canada.
It
was about 36.5 degrees today here in Celsius for my American friends. Here in Tbilisi, Georgia. Warm.
Yeah, it's 30 today. I mean, Canada has a stereotype for being cold, but it gets hot in the summer.
Oh, I know, because you're inland.
Yeah.
So, okay. Have a good day.
Well, thanks a lot, Bern. Great talking to you. And yeah, we'll connect again.
We'll do it again.
Okay. Take care.
Take care.
When I go, I want you to give me 5 minutes. I told you, boys, I'm no escape artist. For the first time, I like the odds.
At the round earth's imagined corners, blow your trumpets, angels, and arise, arise from death, you numberless infinities of souls.